हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू दी फर्स्ट वीडियो लेक्चर्स ऑन इंजीनियरिंग मैकेनिक्स। इन दिस फर्स्ट वीडियो लेक्चर्स आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस यूनिट नंबर वन, दैट इज रिजोल्यूशन एंड कंपोजिशन ऑफ फोर्सेस। ओके, एक्चुअली दी आई हैव डिवाइडेड दिस यूनिट इनटू थ्री लेक्चर्स। ओके, इन फर्स्ट लेक्चर्स आई एम गोइंग टू कवर द बेसिक कंसेप्ट्स ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग मैकेनिक्स, दैट इज what is meant by rigid body, types of forces, classification of forces, and basic units, scalar quantity, vector quantity, like this. And in the next two and three lectures, I am going to cover some additional concept of engineering mechanics and the basic numericals, which are very important from your in-semester examination point of view. Okay, so let us discuss the first theoretical backgrounds of engineering mechanics. Okay, so start. Okay, so you are unit one, that is the introduction to engineering mechanics. Okay, so it consists of principles of statics, force system, resolution and composition of forces, resultant of concurrent forces, moment of force, Wernicke's known theorem, resultant of parallel force system and coupled equivalent force system. Okay, and the next part, there is the resultant of general force system and distributed forces. Okay, centroid and plane lamina is not here. Okay, actually it is a that has been included in the second unit. Okay, so these are the topics we are going to study in unit one. Okay, so now we are going to start some discussing the some few basic definitions. Okay, now first is the science. It is the knowledge about the structure and behavior of natural and physical world based on facts that can be proved. Science is the study of living and non-living living and non-living things. There are various branches of science such as natural science, domestic science, earth science, life science, political science, social science, etc. And physics, chemistry, mathematics, biology, etc. are the few subjects of science. Okay, so this is about the science. Actually, we are, all these things we have discussed in 11th and 12th and our high school education. But as a subject, these are the basics and it will be required for us. Okay, so just we are going a small recap over here. Okay, now next is the physics. It is the sub-branch of science which studies the properties of matter and energy. The field of physics deals with the study of mechanics, thermodynamics, electricity, magnetism, sound, light, nuclear physics, electronics, etc. Okay, now next physics. Next is mechanics. Okay, it is the branch of physics. See, this is important. Means we have to use a lot of concept from the physics for studying the mechanics. Okay, it is the branch of physics which deals with the study of effect of force system acting on a particle or a rigid body which may be at rest or in motion. The purpose of mechanics is to explain and predict physical phenomena and thus to lay the foundation for engineering applications. Okay, this subject is very, very important for irrespective of your branch. Okay, so that's why it is compulsory for all the branches. Okay, now just see the application of engineering mechanics or application of mechanics. See, earlier word is for the mechanics. Now see the engineering mechanics. It is considered as one of the basic subjects for engineering students irrespective of branches, as it develops the thinking and imaginative skill of the students. It supports many other subjects in manufacturing of various products and projects. Okay, that's why engineering mechanics is very important for civil, mechanical, electrical, aeronautical engineers, electrical, electronics, even computer IT also. Okay, now next, engineering. It is the application of scientific knowledge which is used by an engineer to design and manufacture the product that serve the human society. Apart from the God-gifted nature, man has produced many artificial goods which ranges from small pin to huge multi-story buildings. The main role of an engineer is to apply the engineering concepts for manufacturing various products and projects, such as automobiles, aircrafts, electric motors, robots, television, mobile, satellite, construction of roadways, railways, bridges, dams, power transmission towers, skyscrapers, projectiles of missiles, launching of rockets, radar communication structure, trusses, lifting machines like crane, hoist, screwjack, elevator, conveyor belt, cargo ship, submarine, etc. See the how huge applications are there. Okay, so everywhere you will find some small to large application of engineering mechanics. Okay, so that's why understanding the proper subjects of this engineering mechanics will help you a lot for proper understanding the higher classes subjects. Okay, or even proper understanding the engineering. Okay, so please, dear students, be careful. Try to understand each and every concepts covered under the syllabus of engineering mechanics. Okay, so that's further things will become very interesting to you. Okay, now next is the mechanics can be defined as the branch of science which deals with the state of rest or motion of bodies under the action of forces. Okay, so now we are going to classify the mechanics. So mechanics has been classified as follows. Mechanics, basically there has been three classification. Okay, the first is the rigid body mechanics or engineering mechanics. Okay, engineering mechanics is also called as a rigid body mechanics because we are assuming that body is a rigid body. Okay, in next pages we are going to discuss what is meant by rigid body. Okay, means we are going to neglect the deformation of the body. Okay, deformation is there, but the deformation is small, so we are neglecting that. That's why we are treating it as a rigid body. Okay, in second class we are going to discuss the mechanics of deformable bodies. It is also called as strength of material. Deformable body mechanics has been three types: strength of material, theory of plasticity, theory of elasticity. And rigid body mechanics or engineering body mechanics is classified as statics and dynamics. Okay, and dynamics is again further classified as kinematics and kinetics. And third is the fluid mechanics. Fluid mechanics is ideal fluid, viscous fluid, or real fluid, and compressible fluid. Okay, now engineering mechanics treated only rigid body mechanics. Okay, now statics. It is the study of effect of force system on a particle or a rigid body which is at rest condition. If body is at rest and there are forces acting on a body, and if you are analyzing that body at rest condition, then it is called as static. Next is dynamic. It is the study of effect of force system acting on a particle or a rigid body which is in motion. Okay, so effect of rigid body in analysis of rigid body in motion, it's called as a dynamics. Then kinematics. It is the study of geometry of motion without reference to the cause of motion. Kinematics is, it is the study of geometry of motion without reference to the cause of motion. That is, mass and forces causing motions are not considered. That is called as a kinematics. Now, in case of kinetics, it is the study of geometry of motion with reference to the cause of motion, that is the mass and forces causing motion are considered. Okay, this is the basic difference between kinematics and kinetics. In kinematics, mass and force causing motion are not considered, whereas in kinetics it is considered. Now next, some basic concept. Okay, what is meant by space? It is the region which extends in all direction and contains everything in it. That is called as a space. Time. It is the measure of duration between successive event. Time is the basic quantity involved in the analysis of dynamic, but not in statics. Okay. Time's quantity will required in solving the problems on in dynamics. Okay. No, it is not required in statics at all. Matter. It is that which occupies space and can be perceived by our sense, that is called as a matter. Mass, it is a measure of energy of the body, or it is the property of body which measures its resistance to a change of motion. Its SI unit is kg. Its SI unit is kg. That is called as a mass. Then next is a scalar. A physical quantity which requires only magnitude for its complete description is known as scalar. What is the definition of scalar quantity? A physical quantity which requires only magnitude for its complete description is known as scalar. For example, distance, area, volume, mass, work, power, energy, time, density, speed. These are the examples of scalar quantity. Now, next is the vector quantity. A physical quantity which required both magnitude as well as direction for its complete description is known as vector quantities. For example, force. Force is having magnitude as well as direction. Okay. Then displacement, velocity, acceleration, momentum, moment, couple, torque, impulse, weight, etc. These are the examples of vector quantities. Next is the particle. It is a matter having considerable mass but negligible dimension. Size of artificial satellite is negligible as compared to the Earth and size of its orbit. That is called a particle. Now coming to the rigid body. This is very important. It is a matter having considerable mass as well as dimension. It is defined as the body which is capable to withstand its shape and size and does not deform under the action of forces is termed as rigid body. For example, beam and columns of a building structures do deform under the action of loads they carry, but the actual deformation that has been taken place in structures are negligible. Okay, and therefore the body is assumed to be a rigid body. Means practically deformations are there, but compared to the size and shape of the body, the deformations are very small, and that small due to small deformation that has been neglected, that's why body is treated as a rigid body. Okay, now what is note says that it is a hypothetical concept. No body is perfectly rigid in the universe. Assumptions of a rigid body is made in most of the cases when the actual deformation that has taken place in structures are negligible, and such assumptions of rigid body helps for analysis of problems. Therefore, in engineering mechanics, we are going to assume all given bodies are as a rigid body. Okay, so this is about the rigid body. Now next is laws of mechanics, the fundamental principles. The study of mechanics depends on few fundamental principles which are based on experimental evidence. Okay, so first is Newton's first law of motion. Every body continues in its state of rest or of uniform motion in a straight line unless an external unbalance force acts on it. Newton's first law contains the principle of equilibrium of forces, which is the main topic of concern in statics. Okay, so normally, see, engineering mechanics, normally we are having four units. So our first four units entirely depends on the study of statics, and next unit number 5 and 6 is based on dynamics. Okay, so for studying the first four units, we must require the applications of Newton's first law. Okay, and Newton's first law gives the use the equilibriums, means equilibrium concept is depends on Newton's first law. Okay, so this is about the first law. Now Newton's second law. The rate of change of momentum of a body is directly proportional to the force acting on it, and it takes place in the direction of applied force. That is, F is equal to mass into acceleration. This is the Newton's second law. Force is equal to mass into acceleration. Rate of change of momentum of a body is directly proportional to the force acting on it. Where F is the resultant force acting on a body, M is the mass of the body, A is the accelerations. एज पर न्यूटन सेकंड लॉ द एक्सिलरेशन ऑफ अ पार्टिकल इज प्रोपोर्शनल टू द रिजल्टेंट फोर्स एक्टिंग ऑन इट एंड इज इन द डायरेक्शन ऑफ दिस फोर्स एफ इज इक्वल टू एम इन टू ए. दिस लॉ फॉर्म्स द बेसिस फॉर मोस्ट ऑफ द एनालिसिस इन डायनेमिक्स. नाउ नेक्स्ट द थर्ड इज द न्यूटन्स थर्ड लॉ ऑफ मोशंस. टू एवरी एक्शंस देर इज अ इक्वल एंड अपोजिट रिएक्शंस. द फोर्सेस ऑफ एक्शन एंड रिएक्शन बिटवीन इंटरैक्टिंग बॉडीज आर इक्वल इन मैग्नीट्यूड अपोजिट इन डायरेक्शंस एंड कोलिनियर. इट मीन्स दैट फोर्सेस ऑलवेज ऑकर्स इन पेयर्स ऑफ इक्वल एंड अपोजिट फोर्सेस. ओके दिस इज न्यूटन थर्ड लॉ. एवरी एक्शन देर इज इक्वल एंड अपोजिट रिएक्शंस. Now, there is a fourth law, is the same, Newton's law of gravitation. What Newton's law of gravitation says that the force of attraction between any two bodies in the universe is directly proportional to the product of their masses and inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. For example, if M1 and M2 are the masses of two bodies and r is the distance between them, then the force of attraction F between them is given by F is proportional to m1 m2 divided by r square, where therefore m is equal to g into m1 into m2 divided by r square, where g is the universal gravitational constant. Okay, so these are the force Newton's law. Okay, now next fifth is the principle of transmissibility of force. What principle of transmissibility of force says that? It said that the condition of equilibrium or uniform motion of a rigid body will remain unchanged if the point of application of a force acting on a rigid body is transmitted to act at any other point along its line of action. See, this principle is very, very useful while solving the problem both on static as well as dynamics. Okay, so what is actually its meaning? See, in this figure, this is one block on which a force is acting at point A. Okay, and if in the same line of action, if this force is acting at point B, okay, so its effect remains same. Its effect is not going to change. Only thing is that its line of action should remain same. Its line of action should remain same. Okay, this is very important. See, here the effect of this force is pushing at point A, whereas at point B it is pulling effect. Okay, but its effect on the body remains same. From figure A, force F acting on the rigid body at point A can be replaced by the same force F at the point B, provided point A and B lies on the same line of action of the force. Though the nature changes as shown figure from push to pull, but the external effect remains unchanged due to the principle of transmissibility of the force. Okay, while solving the numerical, we have to apply. I mean, sometimes where they are pushing force, we are going to apply a pulling force in the same line of actions. Now, next is the concept of force. Every body at rest has a tendency to remain at rest. Similarly, a body is in motion has a tendency to remain in motion. This is known as the property of inertia. The state of the body changes only if an external agency act on it. Now, what is force? An external force is that external agency. Force is an external agency which changes or tends to change the state of rest or of uniform motion of a body upon which it acts is known as force. Therefore, force F is equal to mass into acceleration. Okay. And a unit of force is Newton, kilonewton. Okay, SI unit is Newton on kilonewton. Okay. And its SI and MKS unit is kg. Mass, normally mass is in kg, but force is in Newton. Okay. Now, there are some properties of the forces, or which is the characteristics of forces. Forces having magnitude of force, it is having magnitude, it is having direction, it is having point of application of the force, means it is acting over a particular point or area. And lastly, the sense of force, that is either is a pulling or pushing. Now, what is mean by 1 newton force? It is a force required to produce an acceleration of 1 meter per second square in a body of mass 1 kg. According to Newton's second law, force is equal to mass into acceleration. Therefore, F is equal to m into a. Therefore, F is equal to 1 kg meter second square. Now, next is weight. The gravitational force of attraction exerted by the earth on the body is known as weight of the body. These force exist when the body is at rest or in motion. Since this attraction is a force, the weight of body is expressed in Newton, in SI unit. Okay, so therefore weight is equal to mass into acceleration due to gravity. Therefore W is equal to m into g. Now see the graphical representation of force. A force is represented graphically by drawing a straight line parallel to the line of action of force. Taking some suitable scale for the magnitude of force, its magnitude is represented by the length of this line drawn to scale as shown in figure. The direction is given by the angle made by the straight line with reference axis and sense by means of an arrow ahead placed at the end of the line. Okay, see, this is the north, south, east, west. This is the O is the point of application, and this is the force acting. This is the direction, it is the sense. EF is equal to 15 meters, which is magnitude 5 centimeter. This is the line of action. Okay, scale 1 centimeter to 10 newton, therefore 15 meters to 5 centimeter, and magnitude is equal to 5 centimeter. This is the graphical representation of the force. Now see the classification of the force system. Force system, there are basically two classifications, coplanar, non-coplanar. Coplanar has been again divided into three: concurrent, parallel, non-concurrent and non-parallel. Non-coplanar has been again classified as concurrent, parallel, non-concurrent and non-parallel. Parallel is again divided into like parallel and unlike parallel. Parallel is like and unlike. Okay. See the force system. When number of forces act simultaneously on a body, then they are said to form a force system. Depending upon whether the line of action of all the forces acting on a body lies in the same plane or in a different plane, the force system may be classified as follows. Depending upon whether the line of action of all the forces acting on the body lies in the same plane or a different plane, the force system is classified as follows. Coplanar force system. If the line of action of all the forces in the system lies on the same plane, then it is called as a coplanar force system. Similarly, on the other hand, non-coplanar force system. If the line of action of all the forces in the system do not lie on the same plane, then it is called as a non-coplanar force system. The two force system can be classified into three groups. Concurrent force system. If the line of action of all the forces in the system passes through single point, then it is called a concurrent force system. This is the concurrent force system. See, this is the one cubic block. These are having there are having six different planes, and these F1, F2, and F3 are acting on this plane. Okay, so this is a coplanar concurrent because all these forces are acting only single plane. Whereas in this case, it is a non-coplanar concurrent, means F1, F2, F3 are acting on three different planes. Okay, but it is a concurrent because all are originating from a same point. Okay, now parallel force system. If the line of action of all the forces in the systems are parallel to each other, then it is called as a parallel force system. Parallel force system can be further classified as into two groups, like parallel and unlike parallel. Okay, see, parallel. Like parallel means if all the forces are going in the same direction, then it is a like parallel. Like parallel. Okay, if some are going in up direction and some are in down directions. Okay, so in that case, it is unlike parallel force system. Okay, see, this is a coplanar like parallel force system because F1, F2, F3 are acting in this plane and all are going in same direction, therefore coplanar like parallel. Whereas in this here, it is a coplanar unlike parallel because here non-coplanar unlike parallel. Now general force system, if the line of action of all the forces in the system are neither concurrent nor parallel, then it is called as a non-concurrent and non-parallel force system. Okay, this is the examples. Now coming to the next composition of force, law of parallelogram of forces. This is a very important law. Okay, most of the times it is statements and its derivation is asked for the 4 to 5 marks in the in semester examination. Okay, so please do this topic in a very proper way. Okay, understand it properly because most there are its applications also. I mean, sometimes its derivation asking for 4 marks and again there will be a problem appearing for the 6 or 7 marks. I mean, this directly it will carry 10 to 12 marks. Okay, so the resultant of any two non-collinear concurrent forces may be found by this law, which states that if two forces acting simultaneously on a body at a point are represented in magnitude and direction by two adjacent sides of a parallelogram, then their resultant is represented in magnitude and direction by the diagonal of a parallelogram which passes through the point of intersection of the two sides representing the forces. Okay, see, these are the P and two Q forces. This is P force, Q force. This is resultant R. This is C and this is theta. It become Q cos theta. It become Q sin theta. Make a drop of perpendicular over here. See, let P and Q be the two concurrent forces having included angle theta acting at and away from point O as shown in figure. They are represented by two adjacent sides OA and OC of the parallelogram OABC. Draw a perpendicular from point B on OA, extend meeting at point D as OC is parallel to OAB and OC is equal to AB is equal to Q and OA is equal to P and OB is equal to R. Therefore, in triangle OBD, where is triangle OBD? This is OBD. This is a right angle triangle. Apply Pythagoras theorem. OB square is equal to OD square plus BD square. Therefore, OB square is equal to OD has been bifurcated OA plus AD. There are plus BD square. And R square is equal to OA is P and AD is Q cos theta and its bracket square and BD is Q sin theta. Therefore, R square is equal to P square plus 2PQ cos theta plus Q square cos square theta plus Q square sin square theta. Therefore, R square is equal to P square plus Q square plus 2PQ cos theta. Therefore, magnitude resultant is equal to R is equal to square root of P square plus Q square plus 2PQ cos theta. This is the first equation of which gives the resultant of the force. And now its direction. Now in triangle OBD, let alpha be the angle made by R with P. Angle made by resultant with force P. Therefore, tan alpha is equal to BD upon OD is equal to BD divided by OA plus AB. Therefore, tan alpha is equal to Q sin theta divided by P plus Q cos theta. Therefore, R is equal to square root of P square plus Q square plus 2PQ cos theta. Therefore, tan alpha is equal to Q sin theta divided by P plus Q cos theta. This equation gives the direction of the force. Now next is the triangle law of force. It is cordially of law of parallelogram. If two forces acting at a point are represented by adjacent sides of a triangle taken in order, then closing sides represent the resultant takes in opposite order. Okay, this P and Q, see this P, draw this parallel to this P, then this Q, this parallel to Q. So this is the direction of P and Q, but it's closing. Now draw this first and last point. The closing sides is indicates its resultant force, and it is taken in opposite order, not in same order. Okay, resultant must be in opposite order. Next is the law of polygon of force. If number of coplanar forces acting on a body are represented by the adjacent sides of a polygon taken in order, then closing sides of a polygon represents the resultant taken in opposite order. Okay, this is the law of polygon of forces. Okay, now see the how to do the resolution. Resolution, a process in which given force is replaced by two components which are equivalent to the given force system. Okay, see, this is the inclined force. Yep, at an angle theta, this is x-axis, y-axis. So its horizontal component fx is f cos theta, and vertical component fy is f sin theta. Similarly here, fx is equal to f sin theta, fy is equal to f sin theta. And sometimes instead of angle, see, fx is equal to f sin theta. See, here angle is given with respect to horizontal. Here angle is given with respect to vertical. So fy become cos theta. Now here, instead of angle, a slope is given. Okay, so in that case, slope we have to calculate. How slope is calculated? Tan theta is equal to y upon x. Therefore, theta is equal to tan inverse of y by x. Okay. And do the resolutions. Okay, by trigonometry, we have the relation of components fx and fy with f and theta. Sin theta, in this case, sin theta is equal to fy by f. Fy by f means opposite upon hypotenuse. Okay, therefore fy is equal to f sin theta. Similarly, cos theta is equal to fx upon f. Therefore, fx is equal to f cos theta. And therefore, f is equal to square root of fx square plus fy square. And its direction, theta is equal to tan inverse of fy by fx. Okay, now sine conventions. Okay, depending upon different quadrant, first, second, third, fourth. In first quadrant, both are positive. Second, first is negative, second is positive. In third quadrant, both are negative, and fourth, positive and negative. This is the one inclined examples. The orientation of x axis and y axis need not be always horizontal and vertical. Okay, sometimes inclined planes are there. Okay, so we have to resolve this. Okay, so how to resolve? This is inclined plane, this is x, y, and this is p. Okay, so it's has been we have to resolve like this. This is p cos theta horizontal, vertical is p sin theta. Okay, this is the way we have to complete. Okay, now see one small example we'll take. Find the component of forces along x and y direction. See, this is a hook is there, on hook the two forces acting 25 newton, 60 newtons, and we have to resolve this. Okay, now see the component of force 25 newton, this is 25. Okay, so its angle is given with respect to this, so this become cos. So this is 25 cos 35, 25 sin 35. So fx1 is 25 cos 55 fx1. See, actually he has done some different way. Actually he has taken, this is 35, so this is 90. So 90 minus 35, he has taken 55. Okay, you will get same answer. Okay, is 25 cos 55 and 25 sin 35, you will get 14.35. okay, doesn't matter, you will take angle either 35 or 55. If you are taking 55 with respect to horizontal, then it become cos component. If you are taking 35 with respect to this, so this vertical become cos component. Okay, then fy minus 25 sin 55, it become minus 25 minus, because see it is going in left direction, so positive, and for vertical it is going downward, so it is negative. Component of force 60 newton, so minus 60 cos 70 minus 20 minus 60 sin 70. Then this is next another problem of resolutions. This is 100 cos 35, 100 sin 35 fy, have power 40. This is horizontal 40 cos 45 and vertical minus 40 sin 45. This force, it is minus 50. Fy is minus 50 cos 55. And it is horizontal minus 50 sin 55. So this way we have to solve the problems. Okay, so I will stop here. This is about the basics of engineering mechanics. Okay, and in next video lectures, we are going to see the applications. Whatever we have discussed in these video lectures, the applications part of this is where to resolve, we have to study the concept of moment, concept of couple, force resolution systems. Okay, where to calculate the resultant force and its directions. Okay, so thank you. I am stopping here and we are going to meet in the next video lectures. Okay, thank you.